I, Aul Fakir Jainulabuddin Abdul Kalam, do swear in the name of God that I will faithfully execute the office of the President of India and that I will devote myself to the service and well-being of the people of India.
As Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam took the oath of office, his mind couldn't but turn back to review what a long journey the small boy from the fishing village in Rameshwaram had completed. Kalam was born in Rameshwaram on 15th October in the year 1931. People here made their living from fishing or coconut farming. Rameshwaram since antiquity has been an important pilgrimage destination. Rama is believed to have stopped here and built the mythological bridge to Lanka when he was on his way to rescue Sita. People come from different parts of the country to pay respects. A bath at the Sagar Sangam, at the confluence of the Bay of Bengal and the Indian Ocean, is considered sacred by many believing Hindus. The temple of Rameshwaram is dedicated to Shiva and houses a lingam which the devout believe was fashioned by Sita herself. Legend has it that Rama, Lakshman and Sita stopped here to pray to Shiva on their way back to Ayodhya from Lanka. Kalam was born in a boatmaker's family. His father, a simple man of limited means, valued education and recognized the talent of his son. Kalam's father regularly took the boat from Rameshwaram to the mythological bridge site at Dhanushkodi, accompanied by young Kalam. This experience had a great impact on the mind of Kalam. The population of Rameshwaram was predominantly of Hindu, with sprinklings of Muslim and Christian households. Each community, as Kalam recollects, lived in harmony and happy contentment. The early years of exposure to different religions helped Kalam understand human emotions and inculcate respect for all religions. The sound of the sea was a constant presence in the life of Kalam. Watching a boat take shape and come to life from pieces of wood and metal was perhaps the best introduction Kalam could have had to the world of engineering. Each day, Kalam would visit the place where the boats were made. No one knew then that the young boy gazing at the boats would one day learn how to make missiles and rockets.
அவர் பறவைகள் தான் பறக்கிறது கள்ளப்புற வந்து பட்டியல் பெரிய பறவைகள் பறக்கிறது அவர் ரொம்ப கண்கூடாக ரொம்ப கவனித்து அது எப்படி போகுது எப்படி வருது அது இறக்கே அப்படியே வெறிச்சமேனைக்கு அப்படியே போகும் அடைக்கும் ஆடாமல் அசையாமல் அந்த பறந்தினுடைய குணம் அப்படியே போ சிறந்துன்னு போகும்.
Kalam began his formal education at the Rameshwaram Panchayat Primary School from the year 1936 to 1944. This was the only school in Rameshwaram in those days. According to Kalam, the teachers here wanted to let the students develop the love for subjects. It was education imparted with love by the teachers.
As a young fellow, when I was a 5-year boy, I used to see in my house a scene. My father and mother, they go for namaz. During the namaz time, I look at them. And they look highly divinity I saw in them. And that inspired me. That scene always inspired me. Whenever I'm in trouble, I remember that scene. When I was a 7-year boy, I used to see in our house veranda. Every Friday, I used to see a scene. One day I asked my father, "See, you look three of you different. My father will have a turban and Pachino Shastrikal will have a pattu jargai. He will have a tupata. And whereas Reverend Father Badal will have a big gown, Catholic gown, and a red belt he will have. So all the three look different." I asked him, "You look different. But what you discuss?" He said, "Son, in life, we belong to three regions, three religions, but in life, remember, son, that you have to work for unity of minds. What we are doing, unity of minds here, our meeting on unity of minds, how a Catholic priest and a Hindu priest and the Imam of a Muslim mosque, three of us assembling, solved Rameshwaram problems."
Some of these people had a deep impact on Kalam. From his parents, he learnt honesty, self-discipline, faith and kindness. And from his closest friends, Jalaluddin and Shamsuddin, he learnt that every human carries something special within himself. These were men who saw a spark in young Kalam and encouraged and nurtured him. From class 8 onwards, Kalam went to Ramanathpuram, to the Schwartz High School. Kalam studied aeronautics at the Madras Institute of Technology. MIT was regarded as the crown jewel of technical education in South India at that time.
He wants to meet all the students, and whenever Kalam visits our institute, all our students are eager to meet their senior. So they feel that they are very much happy to see him as a leader, as an administrator, as a scientist, as a philosopher, as a spiritually motivated person.
Not many know that Kalam's sister, Zohra, had to mortgage her jewelry to pay the sum of 600 rupees for Kalam's admission to the MIT. Aeronautics was a subject that fascinated Kalam. The science of flight held for him the key to freedom, inspiring him to spread wings and soar high. His first close sight of an aircraft was at MIT. Through the meticulous teaching here, a feeling of great excitement about aeronautics was created within him.
We had the pleasure of having him as a professor in Anna University. Dr. Kalam is a fine human being and incarnation of simplicity. And though he adorned the highest office of the land, he continued to be as simple as he was earlier. Friendly to all of us. His attitude is totally positive. I have never seen him saying no. At best, he will say, "Yes, but."
He is not a politician. He is not a film star. He is not this one. But he has inspired every Indian. Best thing to happen to MIT is he is the president risen from come from this institute. See, it is very rarely you see a technically qualified person as a president. He had the highest regard for his teachers. whenever he comes to Chennai, he will definitely visit some of his professors.
In the course of his education at MIT, three teachers shaped his thinking and laid the foundation on which he later built his professional career. These teachers were Professor Sponda, Professor K.A.V. Pandalai, and Professor Narasingha. The dream for a bigger leap and a flight towards freedom was instilled in the mind of young Kalam at the Madras Institute of Technology. This bird, indeed, was destined to fly very high and very far. Kalam, as a child, was fascinated by the flight of birds in the sky. The desire to fly and be among them had grown within him from a young age.
In Dehradun, I went for a Air Force selection, as a pilot selection. There I could not get it because there was a 9 candidate they would select, and I was the 10th candidate. So somehow I could not get it. It's a disappointment. On the way, I happened to see Swami Sivananda. There he asked me, why you are sad, he said. I said, I experienced a very setback. I dreamt to be a pilot, I could not. Then he told me, see, after all, what you have done, the life first time, you have experienced this type of disappointment. And you have to become the captain of the problem and defeat the problem and succeed.
Swami Sivananda told him, as Kalam recollects, accept your destiny and go ahead with your life. You are not destined to become an Air Force pilot. What you are destined to become is not revealed now, but it is predetermined. Forget this failure, as it was essential to lead you to your destined path. Search instead for the true purpose of your existence. Surrender yourself to the wish of God. That lesson made a deep impression on the mind of Kalam. Encouraged by the sage's words, Kalam resumed his research. Kalam worked at NASA, at the Langley Research Center, and at the Goddard Space Flight Center, Maryland. Kalam met Vikram Sarabhai in Mumbai when he received a call for the post of a rocket science engineer at the Indian Space Research Organization, ISRO. What struck Kalam about Sarabhai was the fact that he was not being probed for his existing knowledge and skills. Rather, Sarabhai's questions were an exploration of what possibilities he was filled with. Kalam's first interaction with him was the moment of truth, in which Kalam's dream was enveloped by the bigger dream of a bigger person. Vikram Sarabhai, in the year 1962, was looking for a site to establish a space research station. Sumba in Kerala, next to the Arabian Sea, was selected due to its favorable geostrategic location. Those were tough times. The country had to deal with clothing and feeding millions. Space science was a far-fetched abstract idea. Peter Pereira generously donated the church building that established the first office of the Sumba Space Research Center. It was here that the first blueprints of the Indian space research programs were drawn. Today, it has been converted into a museum that preserves the memories of space exploration. Many youngsters come to relive its exciting memories. Close to the building lies the office of Dr. Kalam. This is where dreams of voyages in space were born. Recognizing the immense socio-economic benefits of space technology, Sarabhai decided in 1969 to establish indigenous capability in building and launching Indian space satellites.
Right from the beginning, it was Kalam seemed to have flown into the national life at a moment which perfectly suited his temperament. Because as I recall it, Vikram Sarabhai was looking for someone who could conceive and build a whole system which is made up of a number of technologies, components and raw materials. He could manage all these technological complexities not by knowing about each and every specialization, but by having a feel for the people and the person who is actually working on that technology.
Rocketry, missiles and other things was very key. So that was there all throughout. He wanted to do them in India. And when he was in the early days in the rockets, before he became SLV-3, he is always a person who was very enthusiastic to do things. He is not afraid of, okay, come on, I am taking up this responsibility. So SLV-3 became a mother ground in which he learned to do a relatively simple satellite with so much of capabilities.
The primary objective of the satellite launch vehicle, SLV project, was design, development and operation of a standard SLV system. Kalam took the executive responsibility of implementing the project.
Kalam as a person, one thing is he had a passion that we have to make this. His unique characteristic is that he can connect with everybody. As I said, as a project team, each one felt connected to him because you can directly access and he also knew what each one is doing. And his unique capability was to assess each individual strength. He never set aside a person as useless.
Kalam can even milk a tiger. Those days the technology has not developed to this extent, it takes a lot of time. Morning if you start, it will go to the next morning. And that occasionally comes, he calls the people and asks them to exchange the people, come and take, and then he sit along with them, make experiences, jokes, theories and everything he discuss. Because he wanted to mingle with the people. That is his culture.
The biggest contribution of Dr. Kalam to ISRO is to encourage youngsters. Second thing, I think, which is very significant institutional thing he had created is failure analysis. Every failure must go through a thorough analysis by multidisciplinary people and then understand it and correct it. So when the first launch failed in 1979, then finally when I went to present the data to Kalam, when I saw him, I started crying because I was just 25 at that time. So the first statement he told me is he put a hand on my shoulder and said, "Do you think we can master the launch vehicle technology with one launch?"
He never loses his heart. He will put in a smile. He say, it's a part of the game. And he will tell a story that, in elsewhere, how many times they failed.
After many initial trials and failures, the SLV-3 dream was finally realized in the year 1980. India's first satellite launch vehicle lifted off from Sriharikota. India, under Kalam and his team, made entry into the small group of nations that possessed satellite launch capacity. While developing satellite launch vehicles, or SLV, one of the biggest lessons Kalam learned was that science is both a joy and passion. He now understood better the role of science and technology, research and engineering in the development of a country. He learned that science is open-ended and exploratory, that it sets out to find answers, like a traveler embarking on a voyage. Another lesson he learned was about the nature of commitment. Kalam had a chance meeting with Wernher von Braun, a giant in the field of rocketry, who told him, "Do not make rocketry your profession, your livelihood. Make it your religion, your mission.
When I joined ISRO, I came across three human beings. One is Professor Vikram Sarabhai. He is a physicist and a visionary. He is a space physicist and a visionary. I directly worked with him. Another person is Professor Satish Dhawan. He is an aerospace expert in the field and a man of mission. Another person is Professor Brahm Prakash. Professor Brahm Prakash is a nuclear scientist. He was my director also. And he is one person I learned that how good character is very important in life. So all he is doing, whatever work he does, is a very clean work he does. And purity of mind, he had a purity of mind. So I learned purity of mind from Prakash, from Vikram Sarabhai, vision, how important vision. And from Satish Dhawan, I learned the aerospace engineering. He was my teacher also.
A sovereign country needs to defend itself against an external adversary. It is absolutely essential to have state-of-the-art, high-tech weaponry in case of any attack. Though India has been importing many sophisticated weapons, but the research and development work by DRDO at DRDL has been exemplary in making India self-reliant in this field. Dr. Ramanna of DRDL offered Kalam a position of the Director of the Defence Research and Development Laboratory in Hyderabad. Kalam immediately accepted the offer, since he wanted space rocket technology to be applied in missile technology. Kalam started work at the DRDO on developing India's indigenous missile program in the year 1982.
He basically wanted India must make their own missile with own technologies and with own specification what is needed by the country defense.
DRDO had an excellent work culture, DRDL, starting from early days. He translated that work culture into a real strength, integrating it with the good review system and a good outward looking, go to wherever the capability exists, whether industry or other labs. He had the ability to appreciate the key problems in any system, recognize and how to find solutions for it.
Selected the people whom he felt would reflect his ethos in program management, in system engineering, in coordination among all various disciplines. Those five people he remained, even today he remains with them.
The projects under Kalam were christened in accordance with the spirit of India's self-reliance. The surface-to-surface weapon system became Prithvi. The tactical core vehicle was called Trishul. The surface-to-air area defense system was called Akash, and the anti-tank missile project was named Nag. Kalam gave the name Agni to his long-cherished dream of REX, or Re-entry Experiment Launch Vehicle. Indian core competence in rocketry had been firmly established beyond any doubt under the leadership of Kalam. The robust civilian space industry and viable missile-based defense has brought India into the select club of nations.
When you are a director of a laboratory and you are also a program director, you have program responsibilities in pushing in a focused manner the development. As a director of the laboratory, you have administrative responsibilities, you have responsibility for maintenance, running and infrastructure. Dr. Kalam's style was very great. In the daytime, he will run the laboratory. In the evening, his project management system starts.
What Dr. Kalam brought in is, it was an independent project mode where the project director can take decisions, can give the finance, get the financial sanctions and move the projects. But Dr. Kalam is a boss there who is also looking into it, but gave the definite freedom to the people. That's how five programs at one go he could move. Simultaneously, he had the guts, rather I mean to say, to start another major laboratory like RCI.
Kalam realized that every vision needs to be executed meticulously if it has to bear fruit. The research center Imarat Laboratory was established to ensure this. It was equipped with state-of-the-art instruments that made it possible for India to achieve the desired breakthrough and become self-reliant in weaponry.
Kalam never used to get lost in detail. He was always, his mind is in a different plane. You may call it a spiritual plane or whatever. I can't describe it.
None can deny his exceptional contribution in enabling India to defend its interests with a thermonuclear device.
DRDO and DAE have effectively and efficiently coordinated and integrated their respective technological strength in a national mission to confer the country with the capability to vacate the nuclear threats.
Accolades and honors followed in a stream. For his exceptional service to the nation, Kalam was awarded Padma Bhushan and Bharat Ratna. It seemed he had reached the zenith. Little did anyone know that the best was yet to come. Kalam was selected as the presidential candidate.
All political parties, they almost unanimously, they had decided to appoint him as president of India. There was an election and he won with a very handsome margin. After he took over as president, he made it very clear that he will be people's president.
Kalam became the 11th president of the Republic of India in the year 2002. The president of India is the head of state and the first citizen of India. He's also the commander and chief of the Indian Armed Forces. The post was established when India became a republic with the adoption of the Indian Constitution. Before Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam became the president, the position was held by men of great eminence, but none before him was a scientist. Kalam began work at a scorching pace, discharging his multidimensional responsibilities with aplomb.
After joining as a president, first 1 month I specialized in constitution. One thing I found, the president is empowered to give the nation the vision for the nation. And definitely he has got an opportunity to talk to the cabinet, talk to the parliament, and definitely can give the vision for the nation, how India can be developed in 20 years time, how it can be transformed economically developed nation, how India can have its own ethics. This is what I realized.
Like his predecessors, Kalam too honored those who have laid down their lives defending Mother India on land, sea and air by placing a wreath at the Amar Jawan Jyoti Memorial. His visit to Rajghat to pay homage to the father of the nation touched many hearts. He removed his shoes before stepping on the consecrated ground and did so himself refusing to use the services of an aide. At the same time, Kalam was well aware of the power of the symbolic action.
I can never forget, I could never imagine a president so simple, so humble and so approachable by ordinary people. And I believe that President Kalam was so successful because he had no political hangover. He tried to instill a sense of confidence among our people, saying you are not second to anybody. He never thought or believed, according to me, that the presidentship, the position of the president of India, Rashtrapati ji, is one only of power and now no duty.
This is what made him take off on a Sukhoi fighter bomber, donning a G-suit and a peaked cap. This wasn't just a realization of an adolescent dream of becoming a pilot, but a powerful statement that the Commander-in-Chief of the Indian Armed Forces had a special relationship with the magnificent men and their flying machines that guard our skies.
The fact that both men and machine have to be tested to the ultimate.
His trip to the harsh, icy, desolate vastness of the Siachen Glacier was even more remarkable. Soldiers deployed here have to cope with enemy fire as well as deal with nature's deadly vagaries. The challenge to keep their morale high is a complex and daunting one. When Kalam mingled with the men in uniform on this front, an unprecedented thawing took place.
I have a connectivity with the people, and there is a link with the people, irrespective of whether urban and rural area. Second thing is, Rashtrapati Bhavan, when I became the president, I opened to the public. 1 year, the million people visited in February, March. You know, the garden, seeing the garden, 1 million people visited. So it's open, Rashtrapati Bhavan opened to the people. Once I had a conference of farmers at Rashtrapati Bhavan. 6,000 farmers from all parts of the country came and assembled in the Mughal Garden in Rashtrapati Bhavan. I took lunch with them. It's a beautiful sight. So I was part of the people.
Bustling with people throughout the day, the garden received lakhs of visitors during the time of Kalam. He cared equally for all human beings, irrespective of their social standing. While on a morning walk in the Mughal Garden, he realized that the security personnel stationed on duty there did not have a shed to protect them from the sun or rain. He immediately got small sheds made for them with provisions of fan and water. Kalam, during his stay at the Rashtrapati Bhavan, added to the Lutyens' architecture yet another marvel. A musical fountain surrounded by a riot of colors, from pure white to vibrant red. The water of the fountain dances to the tunes of Shehnai, a Kalam favorite, and patriotic songs. Kalam often sat across in a small hut, gazing at the fountain, lost deep in thoughts, revisiting in his mind places and people from the distant past. He also set up a biodiversity park. The scientist in him refused to retire. The president was not content to see 100 varieties of flowers bloom in the Mughal gardens. He ordered some Jatropha plants to be introduced here. Not that a few more flower beds would make a difference, but the idea was to make the visitors think about energy crisis and non-conventional options.
Because he was a scientist, he was already well known all over the world, he was a Bharat Ratna, and apart from that he was a scientist internationally acclaimed. So he got very good recognition everywhere. People used to say that we are really enlightened. And I remember his meeting with President Bush in Delhi. And President Bush said, "Sir, I cannot understand many things because I am not an outstanding scientist like you. What you are talking, I cannot understand many things." And similarly, the same comments was made by President Musharraf.
The President of the Republic of India.
The scientific temper and technological background helped him always in his interactions at international forums.
Captivated the people of the planet of my galaxy. O European Union, let your mission spread everywhere like the air we breathe.
He changed the face of India in the international arena.
India has got its own.
Kalam has always had great interest in the field of science and technology and how best it can be harnessed for civilian use.
The connectivity for education, for health, and also for e-governance.
The president discharged his ceremonial duties with great dignity and elan. At the same time, he made it clear that he was a people's president. Kalam shunned pomp and pageantry in everyday life. He was never shy of breaking protocol and behaving like an ordinary person, sharing the joys and sorrows of all.
That of all the presidents of India, he was the most popular. Like they called Diana the people's princess. I think it would be appropriate to describe him as the people's Rashtrapati. Somehow he succeeded in cutting across linguistic divides and factional divides of various kinds to appeal to an entire range of people whose political opinions were diverse, whose social origins were diverse, and whose ethnic origins were diverse. In that sense, he was truly an Indian. And I think somehow he succeeded in communicating this Indianness to the people at large, which is why they lauded him and loved him. And that's a very difficult thing to acquire in any kind of political office, love.
Mahamahim Rashtrapati ji.
When the time came to lay down office, Kalam did so gracefully. Members of Parliament cutting across party lines arranged a farewell for the President demitting office. This was no mere ritual. Most recalled Kalam's term as a refreshing break from the past that had infused a breath of fresh air in the Rashtrapati Bhavan.
मिलकर भारत को 2020 के पहले ही एक विकसित देश बना देगा।
As he moved out of the Rashtrapati Bhavan, he embarked on yet another chapter in his eventful life. He has always enjoyed a special bond with children.
For young people, to succeed in life, they have four qualities. They must have great aim in life. Then continuously they acquire the knowledge. Third, hard work. Fourth, what is called perseverance. These four things should be there.
My state will be clean.
My state will be clean.
If my state is clean,
if my state is clean,
India will be clean.
He has a flair of communicating difficult or abstract ideas in a simple, easy to grasp language. His life is a role model for anybody from any kind of background. His joy when he's with youngsters bubbling with lively curiosity is palpable.
Pyaro dosto, aaj yahan Janata PG College takewar आपसे बीच आकर मुझे बहुत खुशी
The kids too, uninhibited by his reputation as a scientist, treat him with love and affection reserved for the favorite grandparent. Kalam is not a man to rest on his laurels. To borrow his own phrase, igniting minds is what excites him the most. He still finds time to interact with children, sharing their dreams.
I feel youth is the period they have tremendous time and energy. So I used to tell the youth, let not your winged days be spent in vain. You have to navigate the time, because time does not wait for you. You have to navigate the time. So I used to tell them, dream, 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 transform into thoughts, thoughts result into action. That means if you want thoughts, new ideas, new thoughts, what are the sources? Your sources are great books, great teachers, and great human beings.
Kalam, who began writing books at a late stage in his life, felt that the biggest problem the Indian youth faced was the lack of clarity of vision and a lack of direction. It was then that he decided to write about the circumstances and people who made him what he is today. Books for Kalam have been close companions. He discovered some when he was very young.
One is Light from Many Lamps. Light from Many Lamps. This unique book, somewhere 1950 appeared. And this is the story of very great lives and how they encountered the problem and succeeded. So this book is always, I cherish this book. Second one is a Tamil scholarly work of Thiruvalluvar. It is called Thirukural. The Thirukural is every two lines is a very important message for rulers, for the political people, for young people, experienced people. This is a great work. 2000 years back, this Thirukural has been done. That is my companion.
Kalam believes that reading helps to build these invaluable qualities, and the habit of reading can never be encouraged enough.
My life, important components of poetry and music. Now I am 82. The music entered into me when I was a 15 years boy. And of course I love music, Vinay music. One of the important raga I love is Sri Raga.
One of the most satisfying moments for Kalam during his stay in Rashtrapati Bhavan was when the legendary musician Ustad Bismillah Khan performed here.
The tree says, "Oh Kalam, did you see so many nests built by various birds in various parts of my branches? Most of the top branches my tree attract hundreds of parrots as their home. Mission of 100 years of my life, my mission I enjoy, giving what all I have. I share flower, honey, give abode for hundreds of birds. I give and give, so I remain young and happy always."
As a scientist, Kalam has endeavored throughout his life to apply technology and science for the good of mankind.
As we know that nowadays the cardiologists, they use stents. They used to cost about 1.5 lakh rupees. Nowadays they cost 2.5 lakh rupees per stent. Kalam questioned this He said, well, how can you do this stent for so much money? The stent should not cost you that much. They said, no, sir, it is imported, so it is very expensive. But Kalam did not leave it there. He developed a stent for the doctors. Ultimately, this stent was brought to the market. It was called Kalam stent. And this Kalam stent was costing only 12,000 rupees.
I come from a rural area. Nearly 30 to 40 million people, they are in the rural area. And the house is still a joint family system.
Despite his busy schedule, Kalam always found time to visit his ancestral home in Rameshwaram in the state of Tamil Nadu. Though Kalam has remained a bachelor himself, but he has always understood the importance of family. His own background allowed him to comprehend how important family relationships are. In many setbacks and defeats that destiny handed Kalam, he was always able to look within for strength, a habit he inculcated right from his childhood. The most important lesson he learned from adversity was that humaneness, generosity, and understanding can never let you down.
My brother is 97. He's still holding the joint family system. His daughter, son, and all live together. But the joint family system, it should not be broken. So joint family system is very important. I have visited thousands of villages during 5 years period, and I made a point, wherever I go, I visit villages and I know what are their problems.
Dreaming has not ceased. Kalam retains in retirement to inspire persons with his zeal. He has been the moving spirit behind the Technology Information Forecasting and Assessment Council, better known as TIFAC, as its chairman, even before he became the president.
When he came in September 93, he just said, he told those the newly constituted TIFAC, so why not we think ahead in terms of all vital economic sectors for India.
It was here that the vision for a developed India transformed in the work entitled India 2020. This work was co-authored with an old friend and colleague, V.S. Rajan.
TIFAC had a number of missions. And I was heading the mission on composite materials. Again, Dr. Kalam was not only the chairman of TIFAC, he was chairman of his mission also. So we used to have all the benefits of the advice of Dr. Kalam, who was really the forerunner of the non-metallic materials.
The plan initiated a unique methodology to develop key sectors like agriculture, infrastructure, education and healthcare, information technology and defense technology.
Providing urban amenities rural area is a tool in India, 600,000 villages. So there 700 million people live, 70% of the people live. So it is essential to develop the villages for the prosperity of the nation. So we put forth PURA means give the physical connectivity, the electronic connectivity, knowledge connectivity, so that the economic connectivity will come.
This is an exceptional vision that not only has the potential to rejuvenate stagnant cities, but also holds out the promise of bridging the gap between the cities and the villages. It is easy to imagine how this can rebuild a sense of community.
My message to all the young people, any task is done by younger experience, some problem will appear. At no time we should make problem as our captain. We should become captain of the problem, defeat the problem and succeed.
Kalam moved with great men, but never lost the common touch. He rose to the highest ranks in the country, but never forgot that his roots lay in the small town by the sea. He has always retained his childlike curiosity, responded to the young and the old with the same warmth and enthusiasm. There have been many great men who have done India proud. Seldom has a great son of Mother India been loved more.